Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining and welcome to a very special RealSelf webinar event, a real conversation about breast surgery, everything you need to know about breast augmentation. My name is Melanie Rudd and I'm a RealSelf contributing editor. Today's webinar is brought to you in partnership with Mentor. The number one global brand in breast aesthetics, Mentor has a more than 30-year history of offering high quality, innovative products that are rigorously tested for safety. Nearly 7 million women have Mentor breast implants, and the brand is deeply committed to these patients, earning them the highest patient satisfaction rating in the United States. With a variety of silicone gel and saline implant options, including the best-selling memory gel extra breast implants, Mentor offers a wide range of choices for women looking to enhance the appearance of their breasts and increase their confidence. Today, we're going to have a very candid conversation about breast augmentation. It's been the most popular surgical procedure in the United States since 2006, and more women are undergoing the surgery year over year. We're going to be joined by three women, all of whom are at various stages in the breast augmentation journey, and will share candid insight as to every step of the process, from making the decision to have the surgery itself, and the recovery. We'll also be joined by a plastic surgeon who will share her medical insight and expertise and answer common questions about breast augmentation, many of which came from RealSelf social media followers. Please join me in welcoming our panelists. We have RealSelf community member Nicole Walker. Hi, Nicole.
Hi.
RealSelf community member Alex Lindsay. Hey, Alex.
Hey.
And RealSelf community member Amber Bertram Pratt.
Hi.
Good to see you, Amber. And last but not least, of course, we have Dr. Ashley Amalfi, a board certified plastic surgeon in Rochester, New York, and also a RealSelf verified doctor and mentor consultant. Hi, Dr.
Thank Amalfi. Thanks for having me.
Of course. All right, ladies. So let's get into it. We are going to start at the very beginning with the decision to even undergo a breast augmentation in the first place. Obviously not an easy choice. Nicole, I want to start with you because you're our panelist who is at the beginning of this journey and is currently contemplating having the surgery, researching things. So tell us a little bit more about how this process started for you. What made you want to contemplate a breast augmentation and where are you in the process today?
Okay, well, I had always pretty much known I wanted to have breast augmentation from pretty much my 30s. I'm now 48. But I recently, in the last year and a half or so, had a significant weight loss of 20 pounds or more. And so it kind of stepped up the process for me to where I felt like, okay, now some research is really needed. So that's where I am in the process as far as I'm researching doctors and scheduling consultations. And so that's where the step is right now, is trying to figure out, okay, is this the time to do it? Is this the right time? Sure. Is 48 the time to do it?
Right. And Alex, so you are a panelist who fairly recently had a breast augmentation. When you started going through this, what was the reaction you were getting from your family and friends? Was it something you shared? Obviously, it's, you know, can be a tough decision to weigh personally, but then you have other people kind of weighing in and talking. How did your support system, you know, help you through this? Did you share this with them early on?
Yeah, so it was definitely something that I thought on by myself for a little while, because I was like a little insecure about telling people initially. But I got a lot of support from my friends and family. Like, obviously, my friends wanted me to make the right decision and like really think it through, because you are undergoing surgery and that's like a significant step. To do anything, right? But I definitely got a lot of support from my friends. Like, we had a boob day party right before my surgery. And it was always like my decision going forward. Like, my partner was a little hesitant about it initially, but he's definitely like warmed up. He's like very supportive now. But it was something we really had to like talk through on our own.
Right. But like you said, at the end of the day, it was your decision to make. Mm-hmm. And Amber, you are a little bit a year post-surgery, a little over a year post-surgery. What advice would you give women, you know, kind of looking back at the start, as you were researching things, what advice would you give to women who are, you know, contemplating having breast augmentation?
I would say the main thing that I would tell women who are contemplating is that, you know, it's good to go to several different doctors and get several different consultations, because, you know, you walk into a doctor's office or a Zoom call and you do a consultation and the doctor seems so angelic and they just seem so great and they, you know, sell you all of the razzmatazz, you know, and you're like, oh my God, this is a doctor I want to go to. But it makes sense to just get other doctors' opinions, because one may say something about, you know, or suggest something about your body type that the other may not, you know, necessarily think about. There's a lot of doctors out there who are very conservative when they give, you know, breast augmentations. And there's some who are more like, walk down Miami Beach, let's, you know, pop them up there. So, and I definitely got a good range of that when I was going to find which surgeon that was going to do my procedure. So that's like the best advice I can give, is don't just say yes to the first surgeon that you have a consultation with.
Sure. I see Alex is nodding, as is Dr. Amalfi. So, you know, Dr. Amalfi, I want to pose this question to you from your perspective as a doctor. What do you think is the most important thing for patients to do? I have a feeling you're going to be kind of in line with what Amber is saying in terms of doing your research and getting some opinions.
Yeah, I mean, I think the most important thing is you want to vet your doctor. So just because someone advertises themselves as someone who can do this surgery doesn't mean that they've necessarily had the training and the certification to do that. So you really want to make sure that your doctor is not just board certified, but board certified in plastic surgery. So it might look kind of shiny, you know, on the surface, but you want to do your homework and make sure that that person is not just a good fit for you, personality and what you're looking for with results, but that they're also going to be safe and be able to not just handle your surgery, but this is a medical procedure. They need to be able to handle the complications as well. And so finding someone who will take it seriously and can manage not just your expectations, but what comes with it. So I think that's really important. And then ultimately, it needs to be a really good fit. So it's important to tell your doctor what your aesthetic is, what you're looking for. I like my patients to bring in a photo. So not just a photo of what they want to look like, but it's also helpful for them to show me what they don't want to look like, so that I understand what they're looking for. And I will be honest with them and say, you know, yes, we can achieve this, or here are the limitations to getting you where you want to be. And then ultimately, if I feel like I can achieve that patient's goal, then I'm happy to offer that patient surgery. And if the patient feels like I understand them and I get them and they are going to get the result that they want by choosing me, then we sort of commit to that relationship. But it's definitely two-sided, and it's like dating. You, like Amber says, you have to really find a good fit.
Right. Kiss a few frogs before you find your prince, right? Or princess, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
So we go through this process. We find a doctor that, you know, we were comfortable with. We vetted their training, their certification. We're ready to go. I think the next step in this process is deciding between silicone and saline implants, right? And then also figuring out what size, because that's clearly going to affect your end result. So Dr. Amalfi, talk to us about silicone versus saline. I think there's, you know, a lot of kind of misconceptions and urban legends about one versus the other. So, you know, at the end of the day, why choose one over the other?
That's a great question. And it's definitely something that I talk to every single patient about as we're making these decisions. I think when it boils down to it, what you need to remember is both silicone and saline implants, the outer shell is exactly the same. It's made out of silicone. It's just what fills that breast implant that's different. So I have in front of me a Mentor memory gel. Yeah, always. Actually, I use them as elbow rests. So it's always here at my desk. Like
those stress balls when you get stressed.
Yep. And ice packs for the kiddos, because they freeze very well. Mm-hmm. But so these gel implants, silicone gel implants, are filled with just that. They're filled with silicone gel. And so the reason that patients like silicone implants and the reason that we use it more commonly is because it feels amazing. It feels like gel, which is very similar to what tissue feels like or what breast tissue feels like. So the patients who choose silicone implants do it because they really like the way that it feels. A saline implant, again, has the outside that's silicone because those are identical. It's just the filling that's different. And in saline implants, it's filled with salt water, which is what saline is. And so it does feel a little bit more like a bag of water. If a patient already has a ton of their own breast tissue and we're just putting an implant underneath all of that to make it bigger, you might not feel the implant that much either way. So it is a different conversation depending how much of your own breast tissue you have on top of that, how much you're actually going to feel the device. Got it. The reason that patients really like saline implants is because they're water. So if the implant ruptures and their devices, so they fail at, and you know, the rupture rate's incredibly low, but if you're a really young person, you're putting an implant in, it's a long time when you're an old lady with that implant in there, something's going to probably happen to the implant in your lifetime. That's just realistic. So if a saline implant ruptures, it's so easy because it's literally water. So it goes flat like a flat tire. There is no question. You have one breast that is a different size than the other, and it's very, very clear to a patient that they have a rupture. For some people, that just gives them such peace of mind. If a silicone implant ruptures, it usually looks pretty darn good still. So it looks exactly the same for a while. And so for some people, they have anxiety about that. It's completely safe. There's nothing harmful that's going to happen if your silicone implant ruptures, but not knowing makes some people very nervous. Got it. The FDA recommendation for screening of breast implants is to do high resolution ultrasound at this point, which starts at 6 years and is a great test to look for rupture. So that's how we kind of let our patients know what that maintenance is like for your breast implant. But patients either fall into one of those two camps. The patients who choose saline either have a lot of their own breast tissue, so the feel doesn't matter as much, or they just really want to know about that rupture. And then my patients who choose silicone, they love the way it feels, and that's what's important to them. And so they're camp silicone.
Sure. And we're going to go back to the point about rupturing and kind of, you know, keeping tabs on your implants later on in this conversation. But Amber, so going back to kind of the real life practice of choosing, and how did you decide on the size you wanted to go with?
I honestly didn't really know the differences between the different implants. And then, you know, once I started going to my consultations, you know, I got a better idea because I was so focused on researching the doctors that I wasn't even thinking about the type of implant, just like the size. Yeah. And oh, do I want it above the muscle, below the muscle? And so ultimately the doctor that I decided to go with, he was just so patient and so informative in terms of what my options were. And ultimately that's when I decided to do 400 cc's in one and like 445 in another to kind of even them out. And it was great. You know, the results are amazing.
Yeah. And Nicole, have you thought about, possible size or silicone versus saline? You have a top doctor with us right now. So please shoot him her way.
Yeah, actually, Dr. Amalfi, I really want to keep the size. I know that I want to keep the size a more natural look. I'm not interested in the va 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 voom. I'm more athletic, lots of cardio, that type thing. And so is it saline versus silicone as far as the natural look, or does that make a difference? I mean, I know the size, the cc's make a difference, but
yeah, it's a great question.
They shouldn't really look that different. I would say the only difference you will notice is where you can feel the implant. So in areas where women are thin, which tends to be the bottom underside of the breast, you'll really be able to feel the bottom edge of the implant and sometimes even see it through the skin. So what we talk about is rippling. So when the implant moves around, it just naturally gives these little ripples, and saline implants tend to just do that more, the water-filled implants. And so for people who are really thin, that gives a little bit less of a natural look if you can see the bottom of that saline implant or that rippling. So that would be a reason that you might want a gel-filled implant. And then as far as a natural look, it doesn't really matter. I mean, that's when you really want to have someone that you trust, because that conversation is going to be really meaningful when you guys try on different size implants. And I love a natural result. That's like the best compliment. If I can do a breast augmentation and no one knows it's a breast augmentation, it just looks that good. That's a home run for me. And so that's a conversation to have with whoever you choose to be your doc, because the most important thing is going to be the measurements of your chest. So during our consultation, I will take very specific measurements of different landmarks of the chest, the breast, the nipples. And what I'm looking at is something called the breast footprint. So that's where the breast is attached to our body. Choosing an implant that fits into that perfectly is going to give you the most natural result. If we use something that's really narrow, it's going to look really dinky in there. It's going to look like a little golf ball under your skin. It's going to look silly. If we choose something that's way too wide, it's going to stick out over your arm and you're going to look like a linebacker. And if you're a fit runner, that's not, I don't think, the look you're going for, Nicole. So those are the conversations to have. And then when you try on an implant and put that volume in your bra, there's also different projection of implants. So this is a Mentor moderate plus. So this is kind of like a middle of the road implant as far as projection. There's also classic implants, which are a little bit flatter and wider. So it's kind of like more like a pancake if you don't want a lot of projection. And then they become higher in projection where they stick out more. And so when you try those on in your bra during your consultation, you'll really be able to appreciate that difference. So we look at the width of the implant and then also the projection to give you, you know, that natural result or that really big, impactful, augmented look, whatever it is that you're looking for. Mentor has different implants to kind of suit all of those needs, which is really exciting.
And again, this goes back to, I think, our first point, which is finding a doctor that's going to be able to align with your goals and you guys can get on the same page in terms of the aesthetic and the end result. Because as we're learning, it's not as easy as the amount of CCs or silicone versus saline. There's a lot of different things to consider. Amber's pinging me. Do you have a quick question?
Yeah, no, I just wanted to ask Dr. Amalfi really quickly, because I know originally when I went in to get my implants, I wanted like that natural look. And then once they settled and here I am like a year later, I'm like, I wish they were bigger. I wish they were higher. You know, I mean, they look wonderful, but now I want like more. So I was wondering, do you suggest like a high profile implant for someone who wants more of that like Jessica Rabbit, va-va-voom kind of look?
Yeah, I think you're exactly spot on. I think the more projecting it is, then the more dramatic that result is going to be. Or if you really want that look of the upper pole bump, that, you know, like that kind of Baywatch look, there's different implants that we can use to achieve that. So not just high profile, but Mentor has a line called Memory Gel Extra implants, which have extra gel in them. So I like Oreos. I tell patients they're like overstuffed Oreos. They have extra filling. And so if you put that at the top and it's extra full, it's going to give you a little bit more of that bump. So there are subtle things that you can talk to your doctor about to achieve those. And then what you said about wanting to go bigger, we hear that a lot. Like the most common thing that you hear is, I wish I had gone bigger. But you have to remember that, you know, bigger is not always better. And I know that's so silly to say, but with a bigger implant, Amber, it would probably also get wider and you're petite. And you probably would get to a point where you're like, okay, I feel heavier and I don't want to look, you know, bigger. And also bigger implants are heavy. And so it's going to weigh down the skin more. It's not going to stay supported as long. So, you know, oftentimes what we end up choosing is probably the right fit for your body. And I think people get really swollen after surgery and they get really used to how swelling looks. And, you know, maybe someday we'll know how to recreate that. But when the swelling goes down and things settle, they do get a little bit more natural looking.
We can talk more about this. You guys should definitely talk about this more offline. I want to keep things going just in the interest of time. We're going to talk about swelling in a second. But let's talk about the actual surgery itself, right? We've talked so much about making the decision and getting to this point. Now it's surgery day. Dr. Amalfi, first kind of walk me through, give us the, you know, cliff notes of what a breast augmentation is like, how long it takes, some things people need to keep in mind kind of the day of the surgery. And then I'm going to ask the ladies here who have had surgery to talk us through their firsthand experience.
The surgery itself is really simple. And I think that that's what people are so kind of blown away by at the end, that they feel so great. It is a super fast surgery. We book it for an hour. I mean, my breast augmentations yesterday and the day before were 33 minutes and 35 minutes. So it's super fast. We make a tiny pocket in the body to put that implant in. So a little home where it's going to live, whether that's under your muscle or on top of your muscle. Going under your muscle is a little bit more sore and can have a little bit more bleeding. So that operation might take just a little bit longer, but still well under an hour. Patients go home with a little surgical bra, which is like a sports bra. There's no drains to take out, no stitches to take out. Everything heals underneath the skin. And you're really in and out. So we perform our surgeries. We have our own operating room in our office. And so we have an accredited facility. You come in, you have a very private visit. Your nurse takes you to the operating room. You go to sleep, you wake up, you have the breasts you've been dreaming about, and then you get in the car and go home. And so it's a very straightforward and reasonable day.
What about doing, and Nicole, you know, I'd love if you want to chime in here too, because I know you were also considering possibly a lift as well. So Dr. Amalfi, is that something you do a lot, a breast lift in conjunction with an implant, with an augmentation?
It's probably the most common combination surgery I perform. It's my absolute favorite thing to do together. There are some doctors who are not comfortable combining those two surgeries. It's technically a very difficult thing to do, because with a lift, you're making things smaller and tighter. And with a breast augmentation, you're making something bigger. And so it's two opposing forces. You have to really understand the techniques and understand how it's going to last over time to do them together. So if you're looking for a doctor to do that, you would definitely want to ask them if that's a common combination for them. And, you know, maybe ask a step further and say, you know, how often do you perform a surgery combination like this? Because it is more difficult to have a predictable result, but it's a beautiful operation. It will lift your nipple and put it in an ideal location. It can help to reshape the breast. And it will ultimately give you a really good long-term result, because when I do that combination surgery, I remove some of that heavy breast tissue that hangs off the bottom of the implant. And so patients are going to have a perky breast longer because gravity is not going to pull down that bottom tissue. So we see that for patients like you, Nicole, who've had weight loss, or for moms who've had kids and breastfed and they have some sagging and or are unhappy with the nipple position, or just are unhappy with the shape or symmetry of their breasts. If one is a lot larger, then that combination surgery can make the breasts equal, and then we can augment them with a similar sized implant.
Perfect.
Okay, and as far as the combination, I get that. What about if patients just were considering a breast lift, that compared to implants, what would the result be? I mean, as far as long-term, I guess you're not going to get the best benefits long-term with just the breast lift, correct?
It's going to give you a really different look, because a real breast, especially with time, we get that natural ski slope shape to the top of the breast, and an implant does the exact opposite. So the implant is the only way to fill that upper part of the breast that we lose when we have kids or breastfeed or lose weight. And so the only way to restore upper breast volume is with a breast implant. That's the only option. A lift will just tighten things and move your nipple, but won't give you that upper change.
Perfect.
Oh, interesting. So going back to the surgery day, Alex, you know, this was a couple of months ago for you. We'll get to recovery in a second, but in terms of just the actual surgery experience, the day of, what do you remember? Were you nervous? How did you feel? Give us the lowdown.
Yeah. I was super nervous. I was really excited. But like, it's the same feeling in your body where you're just like, I was really excited. When I got there, like my doctor also, his office, like he also had his own, surgery center there. So, his wife wife was actually my nurse. So I got to like, they're all like very well connected and I got to meet them the whole time. So I knew my nurse though, like my entire time, every time I went in for a visit, I saw her. So it was really private and comfortable. I showed up like an hour and a half, 2 hours before surgery, got checked out, and then they just kind of put me to sleep. I woke up, I wasn't sore at all when I woke up, but I remember being really shocked that my breasts were so hard. I was completely in awe of how hard they were. I was kind of scared because I was like, oh my god, are they gonna be like this forever? Which obviously I knew they weren't, but I was kind of a little drugged out. But I wasn't in pain. I was just kind of super woozy. And then like ready to knock out. So it was a really easy, like, honestly, like I've had a septoplasty before. That was a much harder surgery. Like this was a much easier experience.
Great. So then moving on to the recovery, was the recovery, do you think, equally easy? Was this, you know, even as we were pulling questions for this webinar, I think that the overarching top questions we got were about recovery. And that seemed to be the one hang up that was stopping a lot of people from having the surgery, concern about recovery time, inability to, you know, chase after their kids or work out or, you know, go to their jobs or whatever. So like on a scale of 1 to 10 overall, Alex, 10 being crazy, crazy hard, 1 being super easy, where would you rate your recovery?
Honestly, probably like a 4 or 5. Like it was maybe on the lower end of that. Like I was probably out of commission for like 3 days fully. I could lift my arms and had full like dexterity within a couple days. I was still kind of like I was still taking pain medication for like 5 days or so, but like truly it like as soon as you get past the point where it stops hurting, which is at like day 5, like it stops like hurting constantly, and you're just like a little sore, it's so easy. Like I was back to work within like 4 or 5 days, and I worked at a bookstore, so it wasn't like crazy physical or anything, but it was a really easy recovery. Like RealSelf was actually really helpful for like advice and tips on like buying compression bras. I had my incision on the nipple. So when I was a little nervous about like stitches and stuff like that. But like RealSelf was really helpful in navigating that kind of stuff and buying the right things to like clean my incisions off with and all that. But it was a really easy, like super straightforward, nothing too crazy.
Yeah. Amber, so Alex rated it at like a 4 or 5. What would you rate your recovery process?
Say about the same, about a 4 or 5. I'm sorry, go ahead.
So yeah, so you guys are in agreement. So that's really, I think, not as scary maybe as women might think. But Dr. Amalfi, give us your kind of top 5 tips for women who are recovering, you know, things either to do or not to do. You know, Alex mentioned compression bras. That was another common question we got about what types of bra do you need to be wearing after a breast augmentation and for how long?
I mean, I think kind of the big hitters after surgery are, number one, if you can take a week off of work, just take a week off of work, because the more you allow yourself to heal early on, the faster and better your recovery will be. So the more you listen to and do all the things you're supposed to do right away, right after surgery, the quicker you're going to just be back to normal without a hiccup in the recovery process. So if you can do that, great. If you're working from home, amazing. I mean, you can log on in a day. I mean, that's why we are just doing so much surgery right now. Aesthetic surgery has just never been busier because everyone works from home. So if you have a job where you can log on, then I wouldn't even hesitate. This is the time to do it. Other big things are, number one, get some help from family and friends. So women, as women, we're so scared to ask for help, you know, and all our friends are like, oh, what can I do? You know, everyone wants to help you. Give them something to do. Tell them that, you know, what would be awesome? Bring dinner. You know, mom wants to help you. Can you vacuum the house? Because I probably shouldn't vacuum right now. Just do it. It's so hard for us as women to ask for help or to just get help. And the more you kind of lay low, the quicker and the better you're gonna feel. I tell patients, don't go crazy buying too many, you know, bras or special things. Like, it's really straightforward. We provide our patients with surgical bras as part of their post-operative package, but you can also just purchase a sports bra. I tell patients it's easier to have something that zips or buttons in the front because it's hard to put your hands over your head. And you just want a stretchy sports bra. You're going to wear that for a few months as your incisions heal. And it's going to be the most comfortable thing for you. So if you want to buy just a couple to have on hand, keep the tags on them because you kind of don't know what size you're going to be. And that's a hard thing to predict. So just don't take the tags off of it. And then you can kind of take anything back. Sure. But those are some of kind of the big things for recovery. Ask for help, be prepared, take it easy at first so that your recovery is nice and quick, and just a few bras.
And keep the tags on the sports bras. Amber, what do you think women should consider, forget the kind of the logistical things you need to do or not do, but just from an emotional perspective after you've had the surgery and now, you know, your whole body has changed, right? And so what did you think the first time you looked in the mirror after the surgery and saw your new breasts? How was the emotional component of recovery for you?
Honestly, I was like, yeah. Like, as soon as I felt like I really loved my body beforehand. You know, I just had a couple of kids and they sucked the life out of my breasts. So I just wanted to put, you know, that small piece back together. And when I put on, you know, what's the first thing we do? We put on a bikini. And I was just like, yeah, oh yeah. You know, I don't know how many like selfies I took. You know, and I'm showing my husband and he's like rolling his eyes because he's like, all right, you know, I've seen it. You know, I'm walking around the house, you know, topless with around my kids and stuff, because I'm just like, I'm so happy that like, yeah, they look exactly like I wanted it. And, you know, there's nothing better than, you know, contemplating a surgery, and it's not cheap, you know, spending the amount of money that you spend to do this, to change the rest of your life. And then it comes out exactly how you want it. I mean, you can't ask for anything better.
Yeah. It sounds incredible. It sounds like such like, you know, that magical kind of confidence boost. I mean, not overnight, but kind of, right? Dr. Amalfi, I want to touch on something we talked about earlier quickly about the swelling and why it's important for women to, you know, Alex said her breasts were really hard right after. Why is it important for women to not judge their, you know, what their breast looks like 1 week post-surgery? Like, how long do you need to wait before you can really judge that end result?
Yeah, a lot happens in surgery, especially if we're putting your implant under your muscle. That causes a lot of inflammation and a lot of swelling, and that muscle kind of tightens up. And so it causes everything to be rock hard and really, really high and tight until your body relaxes and allows it to settle in. That time frame is different for everyone, but I would say by 3 months on average, things have really settled out. And gravity kind of works from the top down. So the top part of your breast is what will soften up first because the bottom part remains the most swollen. And then you can kind of just track how things are starting to feel. And once it will feel like totally normal tissue. And so once it feels like normal tissue, you watch that they continue to like round out and settle and they just get more beautiful and sort of look like they're just a part of your body as they age. So usually that process for most women is about 3 months.
Right. And then you also mentioned in terms of people being concerned about ruptures and things like that, you said the new guidelines are for ultrasound screening every 6 years, correct?
So the newest FDA guidelines are for ultrasound screening starting at 6 years.
Starting at 6 years, got
it. Yep. We used to start that sooner, but because rupture rates are so low, about 1% per year, we were doing too much screening. And also the former guidelines were MRIs, which is number one, very expensive and probably unnecessary because ultrasound is just as good of a tool. And so that's why those recent guidelines have changed. So I like to see my patients every year just to touch and feel their implants, make sure they still feel soft and nothing's changing and they don't have any concerns. And then when they hit that 6 year mark, we send them for a high resolution ultrasound.
But this whole kind of trope that floats around the internet, oh, you need to replace your implants every 10 years, that's not necessarily accurate.
That's something I answer almost every day.
Yeah.
So I tell patients, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Now, the rupture rate, you know, is going to be around 10% of confirmed ruptures at that 10-year mark. So that means that 90% of implants are great, you know, but women, about a quarter of women at that time frame want a different surgery. So maybe they're like Amber, and for years and years and years, she wants to just go a little bit bigger. And at 10 years, she's like, you know what, I'm ready to do it. Well, then that makes sense. And that's a reasonable time to exchange your implants. Or maybe you just had a breast augmentation and 10 or 15 years later, you've had kids and things have changed and your weight has changed. And now maybe you need a breast lift. So if we're going to do a breast lift and your implants are 10 years old, well, let's just exchange those out and put in a new pair of breast implants. So if it's a time frame where you're thinking about doing something else, then the reasonable thing is to just put in new implants and start over. But if everything is beautiful and you're super happy, they do not have to come out. I mean, I've taken implants out that are older than me and are fine and beautiful okay. and not ruptured. So way to go for that person. They've got, you know, so it's not a hard and fast rule, but if your implants are getting that old and there's something that you maybe want to change, then I think it's a discussion worth having.
Sure. I think that's a good point and good thing for people to keep in mind as they consider this. Well, ladies, thank you so much for joining me today and being so candid and open and talking about your breasts. I really appreciate it. And thank you to everybody at home for joining us. Attendees who watch this webinar live will be eligible to receive a refund for a breast augmentation consultation. So please stay tuned and look out for an email with more details on that special offer. And please follow RealSelf on Instagram at RealSelf, Mentor at Breast Implants by Mentor, and Dr. Ashley Amalfi at Dr. Ashley Amalfi as well. Please stay tuned for more exclusive webinar events in the future, and we hope to see you all soon. Thanks so much, everyone.